As global temperatures keep increasing and climate change affects growing numbers of people, adaptation becomes imperative, particularly in semi-arid regions. Often, adaptation interventions focus solely on technical solutions, such as drilling boreholes to access groundwater for irrigation or promoting drought-tolerant varieties that may not be culturally acceptable. Too often, they are implemented top-down and ignore the obstacles that power structures and poor or unfair governance poses for gender justice and equality goals. The perspectives of affected communities and individuals are rarely taken into account, and if consultation occurs, it tends to rely on those who have more voice, recognition, or power. Technical solutions are indeed important, but when designing and implementing them, we need to consider how underlying social and institutional dynamics will create winners and losers. A first step is to recognize that adaptation interventions affect different groups of people in different ways. How different people and even different members of the same household experience and respond to risks varies, depending on factors like age, marital status, ethnicity, gender, and class. Predominant social norms or laws and regulations also shape and can limit a person's agency and how they can respond to climate change. If adaptation projects pay more attention to people's well-being, they will be more effective. A well-being approach helps humanize these efforts, making them less technocratic and closer to what people need and care about. It recognizes that not all people have the same ability or motivation to adopt adaptation measures. It also goes beyond the material dimension, such as income, to also consider subjective aspects like perceived quality of life or issues like social cohesion and support. Effective adaptation must be based on and reflect people's needs and aspirations, as well as acknowledge the resources and capacities people have and how these shape livelihood choices and resilience. New approaches to climate governance are needed to allow numerous and diverse opinions and voices to be heard, especially those typically excluded. Participatory scenario building processes and vulnerability assessments, for instance, enable people to have a say about decisions that affect them and to discuss what affects their well-being. Decision makers also need to understand that people have different aspirations for their lives and that these change over time. Aspirations often determine what is most important for individuals and can give entry points into what motivates them to undertake certain livelihood and risk management choices, including employment, migration, or adopting certain adaptation practices and not others. Understanding the unique cultural, social, and ecological context of each community, the different factors that influence people's vulnerability and ability to respond to risks, and what influences their well-being is crucial for effective policymaking. We need to work more closely with stakeholders to design and develop adaptation interventions, as in the end, adaptation is about people.